Good day, and it's so good to be here with you, and thank you once again for inviting me into your places. And I pray that God will bless you as you listen to today's message from God's Bible, and that you will be blessed in that way. I want to begin with a story of a man who worked very hard all his life and saved his money. But he's also known as a miser who loves his money more than most things in life. And he had asked his wife that when he died, his wife would take all his money and place it in the casket with him. And of course, one day he died, and there he was, stretched out in his casket while his wife looked on, sitting with her best friend. And after the funeral ceremony, the undertaker was about to close the lid on the casket. The grieving widow said, "Please wait and stop." And she took a shoebox and she placed it in the casket, and then the undertakers closed the lid on the casket for the last time. Her best friend asked her, "I hope you weren't crazy enough to put all that money in there." And she replied, "Yes, I promised. I'm a good Christian. I can't lie. I kept my promise to my husband." And her friend responded, "You mean to tell me you put every cent of his money in the casket with him?" And she said, "I sure did. I got all his money together, put it into my account, and I wrote him a check." There's a story of another man, a very, very wealthy man who had 7 sons and 3 daughters. He was a godly man who was blameless and upright. He was great among his own people. He's a man who feared God and hated evil. Yet one day all that he had, all his possessions, everything was taken from him. It began with his animals. He had flocks of sheep and cattle, and he had horses and donkeys and who knows what else he had. All of it was taken, gone. And the man who employed many to work in his fields and his farms, they all left as well. And worst of all, in the freakiest of all storms, all of his children were killed at one time. The man was devastated. He fell to the ground and he cried out, "Naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked I will depart. The Lord gave and the Lord has taken away. May the name of the Lord be praised." There's another man who was in prison. Not the kind of prisons that you might think of today, but this was a dark, cold, desolate prison. And he said this, "I have learned to be content, whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do everything through Him who gives me strength." Please turn in your Bibles to the letter of Timothy, 1 Timothy chapter 6, as we read from the second half of the second verse to verse 10 together. So, 1 Timothy chapter 6, 2b. "These are the things you are to teach and insist on. If anyone teaches otherwise or does not agree to the sound instructions of our Lord Jesus Christ and to godly teaching, they are conceited and understand nothing. They have an unhealthy interest in controversies and quarrels about words that result in envy, strife, malicious talk, and evil suspicions, and constant friction between people of corrupt mind who have been robbed of the truth and who think that godliness is a means to financial gain. But godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into the world and we could take nothing out of it. But if we had food and clothing, we shall be content with that. Those who want to get rich fall into temptation and a trap and into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. Some people, eager for money, have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs." The Lord bless the reading of His word. Let us pray. Almighty God, we just thank You for Your word, Your holy Bible. As we ponder, as we work through these verses, we ask, O Holy Spirit, for Your discernment and wisdom, and illumination. Help us to understand what this means for us today in our time, in our context. But also, Lord, help us to put it into practice, that you would be glorified in all things. Amen. Well, we have arrived now after a number of months, if you've been tracking with this series, What is the Church? We've arrived here to the meat and potatoes of this final chapter of Paul's letter. And we see here right from the beginning that Paul now returns to the very reason he wrote his letter to Timothy and the church in the first place. For Paul said this in the very beginning of his letter, so that you, that is Timothy, may command certain men not to teach false doctrines any longer or to devote themselves to myths and endless genealogy. See, now Paul's returning to the exhortations about false teaching in the church of Ephesus. And these few men of influence in that church in Ephesus so long ago had seduced the minds and the hearts of some of the people. They were promoting, as Paul himself said, controversial speculations, thereby creating disorder and all sorts of other problems in the church. But more importantly, these wolves in disguise had strayed from what Paul said in the first chapter, Paul saying, advancing God's work, which is by faith. They had strayed from that goal, that command by God. And Paul summarizes all that he instructed now by saying this, which we read together, these are the things you are to teach and insist on. What things? Everything he has exhorted, everything he has commanded, everything he has talked about from the very first verse of this letter up until now. Please notice now as we look at verse 3 together. Here we find the benefit, if you will, the blessing of advancing God's work, which is by faith. And that blessing is that benefit is what? Sound instruction. Now, your translation may have it translated wholesome teachings or something like sound words. But here's the point. The word sound in the original language, the Greek, means healthy. So Paul is using medical imagery here, a medical term, as many of the ancients did to diagnose the state of a person's soul, his belief or her belief. So what was the healthy instruction that Paul prescribed for the soul? Well, it's right here in verse 3 where Paul said, the sound instruction, the sound teaching, the sound doctrine, however you want to put it, of our Lord Jesus Christ and to godly teaching. Sound instruction, healthy instruction. This sound instruction, Paul said to another fellow by the name of Titus, which is just after the second Timothy in our letters here, he said this, is the knowledge of truth that leads to godliness. Now, as we will see in a moment, godliness for a follower of Christ, for a true believer, is one part of a whole. One part of a whole. And the whole is godliness with contentment. They go hand in hand. They are the whole. See, but false teachers then, in Paul's day, and today, are anything but content, anything but sound or healthy. As Paul said, they are conceited and understand nothing. They are conceited and understand nothing. So as we take verse 3 and 5 together, Paul there highlights for us six characteristics of false teachers. Six characteristics. And let's go through them one at a time. Number one, they do not agree with sound instruction. See, false teachers do not agree with the knowledge of truth that leads to godliness, which he said to Titus. False teachers are opposed to what Paul said at the beginning of his letter again, sound doctrine that conforms to the gospel of Christ concerning the glory of the blessed God. They do not agree with sound instruction. Secondly, false teachers are conceited. They are conceited. He says this here in the letter. Paul does say that. Dictionary.com defines conceited as, quote, having an excessively favorable opinion of one's abilities. There's other ways of describing a conceited person. How about arrogant? How about loudmouth? How about full of hot air? How about stuck up? How about know-it-all? Good description of conceited people. Now, if you remember, if you've been following through this letter together with us, Paul gives Timothy instructions about selecting elders in a church. And he needed to do that to sort things out. And he said this, that Timothy, if you pick an elder, and we see this in the third chapter, he must not be a recent convert, or he may become conceited and fall under the same judgment as the devil. He could become conceited, tempted. He could become arrogant. He could become a loudmouth, etc. Now, Paul writing to Corinthian church in his first letter, and they had their own things to deal with there for sure. Paul said to them, we all possess knowledge, and isn't that not true? We all have some knowledge of something. Then Paul said this very interesting statement, but knowledge puffs up while love builds up. Knowledge puffs up while love builds up. Now, how true that is? Well, number three, false teachers understand nothing. That's what Paul says here. They understand nothing. The question is why? Why don't they understand nothing? Paul said to Timothy in his second letter, evildoers and imposters will go from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. Evildoers and imposters, false teachers, will go from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. False teachers understand nothing, not because they lack knowledge, but because they are being deceived. They are deceiving and being deceived. They're being sold a bill of goods. They are buying those goods from their father, whom Jesus called out concerning the Pharisees. Those false teachers, where Jesus said to the Pharisees, you belong to your father, the devil, and you want to carry out your father's desires. False teachers understand nothing. They are deceived and they're being deceived. And they bought the goods of their father, the devil. Now, the prophet Obadiah was given a vision by God for Israel. And this will be the final comment for this third point. God said through Obadiah, the pride of your heart has deceived you. Pride has deceived you. Number four, false teachers have an interest in controversies. The false teachers in Ephesus were more interested in controversial issues, such as Paul describes in this letter, myths and genealogies, whatever they were. They were more interested in adding to the gospel. It was Jesus plus, 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 instead of only Jesus. Let me ask you this question. How about today? Do Christians today get caught up in controversial issues? Of course we do. We've certainly seen this over the last few years during the pandemic. How about petty controversial issues? Do Christians today get involved in that? Of course they do. You know, the pastor preaches too long, preaches too short, his beard is too short, it's too long, the carpet's not right color. I don't know. Think of some petty controversial issues. But about false teachers, let's get back to them. They really have what I'm calling a master's degree, a PhD, if you will, when it comes to controversies. They're masters of controversies because they are deceived and trying to deceive others. Number five, false teachers quarrel about words. Now, the New Living Translation puts it this way. They quibble over the meaning of words. I like that. It sounds more understandable. Quibble over the meaning of words. Now we want to go to Jesus, who will give us some commentary to help us understand the very nature, the very heart of this particular characteristic of false teachers, that they quarrel about words. Now, shortly before Jesus was arrested, he faced off against the teachers of the law and the Pharisees over their hypocrisy. These were the leadership, the religious leadership of Israel. And he faced off against them. And we have a record of that in the Gospels. And I'm going to pick out Matthew's record, for example, for us in chapter 23 of Matthew's Gospel, what is called the seven woes that Jesus said to the Pharisees. Woe to you. And the one that I want to point out for us goes like this. Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites. You give a tenth of your spices, mint, dill, and cumin. But you have neglected the more important matters of the law, justice, mercy, and faithfulness. You should have practiced the latter without neglecting the former. You blind guides, you strain out a gnat but swallow a camel. This is what is happening with these false teachers. The fifth characteristics, quibbling over the meaning of words. They strain out a gnat and swallow a camel. Friends, those responsible for God in Israel's day to call the people to the worship of God, the true, holy, just, and merciful God, these, however you want to call it, created a religion of their own sinful desires, just like false teachers do today. They quibble over the meaning of words, really revealing that what Jesus said about false teachers. What did Jesus say? Listen to this. You are like whitewashed tombs who look beautiful on the outside, but on the inside are full of the bones of the dead and everything unclean. In the same way, on the outside you appear to people as righteous, but on the inside are full of hypocrisy, and wickedness. So what is the result of these kinds of things with false teachers, these characteristics? Well, Paul gives us five of them right here in his letter. Envy, strife, malicious talk, evil suspicions, and constant friction from people of corrupt mind. Nothing good will come out of it for the church or for the world. And Paul hits this on the nail when he said this about false teachers and their, what I'm calling, groupies, their followers. They have been robbed of the truth. Verse 5 here. They've been robbed of the truth. And I want to ask us another question here. What is the opposite of a corrupt mind? These folks have a corrupt mind, according to Paul. Well, Paul, writing to Titus, who was dealing with what Paul called in that particular context, rebellious people full of meaningless talk and deception. These were the ones that Titus had to deal with that were disrupting whole households by teaching things they ought not to teach, and that for the sake of dishonest gain. These Paul called corrupted. But then he gives us the polar opposite. He said this to Titus, to the pure, all things are pure. All things are pure, but to those who are corrupted and do not believe, nothing is pure. So what is the opposite of a corrupt mind? A pure mind, or let's just put it this way, a godly mind. A one who thinks on godly things. Well, folks, now we have, last but not least, the sixth characteristic of false teachers. False teachers think that godliness is a means to financial gain. False teachers then and today come under the judgment of Christ for their greed. For Jesus said this, you Pharisees clean the outside of the cup and dish, but inside you are full of greed and wickedness. I want to spend a little bit of time on, as we bring this through the last few verses, 6 to 10, on this sixth characteristic of false teachers, greed. And quite frankly, it is one of the most noticeable and easily detected characteristics in a person, no doubt also, and also in false teachers. But it often comes disguised with sort of cliche sayings, you know. The greed gets disguised under, for example, it's the work of the ministry, or the lost need to hear the word, or it was a gift, and things like that. But Paul wouldn't have fallen for those kind of explanations, because he says here in verse 6, but godliness with contentment is great gain. He wouldn't have bought that, because he knew where great gain came from. See, this is the way God does accounting. This is the way God does math. And this is his math formula. Godliness plus contentment equal great spiritual gain. Godliness plus contentment equal great spiritual gain. Remember the man in the prison? I hope you've guessed who that was. Who said, I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation. Well, King Solomon had something to say about that. King Solomon said, better a little with the fear of the Lord than great wealth with turmoil. He also said this, better a little with righteousness than much gain with injustice. Better a little. We turn to the book of Hebrews, the letter to the Hebrews. And there the writer knew that his audience was suffering under persecution for their faith in Christ. And he reminded them not to forget the brothers and sisters in prison, those who were suffering and being mistreated. He exhorted them to keep the main thing the main thing. For temptations to conform in their culture some 2,000 years ago were great, as it is in our culture today as Christians being tempted to conform. And he said that there many will be poor. And then he said this, keep your lives free from the love of money and be content with what you have. Because God said, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. As we think about our own context, I think you and I have a problem. And did you recognize the problem we have? We, whatever we call ourselves, the middle class or however we define that, as one commentator put it, is, quote, understand rich much differently from the way of Paul's first readers would have. See, poverty was very common in the first century. The difference between the rich and poor was vast. And most people of Paul's day would have seen you and me today as rich. We've got to get that sort of in our heads, understand that context in ours today. Yet there is one thing that we have in common with the first century as well, and that's we have with them, that is greed. And Paul reminds us that we brought nothing into the world and we take nothing out of it. Paul's citing a very common saying, a saying that had been around a long time before Paul and remains to this day. I mentioned to you the rich man, the godly rich man, who said, naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked I will depart. Remember the miser who wanted to take his money to the grave? Well, King Solomon said this, everyone comes naked from their mother's womb, as everyone comes, so they depart. Friends, rich, poor, middle class, however you want to define that, we all start life naked and we end life naked. Then Paul would obviously say that very next thing, at least it is obvious to me, I hope it is to you. In verse 8, Paul said, but if we have food and clothing, we will be content with that. And now the Greek here, the way it's all put together, also would imply shelter. What Paul is doing here is describing the basic needs of all human beings back then and today. Food, clothing, and shelter. Those are the basic needs. But as we think of our own context, there's an elephant in the room. Do you see it floating around? Do you see it floating around? That'd be something to see a floating elephant. Walking around. Do you see that elephant? You know, that silent response that maybe that we have in our minds or you have in your minds, however it goes. Does God want me to be destitute? You know, sell it all, sit on the hill, and hopefully somebody will feed me. Well, we need to put that elephant back in its proper place. Ask yourself this question. How can anyone be content if they are destitute? How can they? Without food, clothes, or shelter. That's not going to happen. And the Bible doesn't teach this, and God doesn't command this for you and me to be destitute. Let's go back to the book of Hebrews. Remember, after exhorting the readers to live free from the love of money and assuring them that God would never leave them or forsake them, he said this, so we say with confidence, the Lord is my helper, I will not be afraid. What can mere mortals do to me? Friends, ask yourself this question. What does God want from me? What does God want from me? Listen to the wisdom of Proverbs. Keep falsehood and lies far from me. Give me neither poverty or riches, but give me only my daily bread. Does that sound like contentment? Does that sound like godliness? So are you worried about food, clothes, and shelter? How about we just up it a bit? Are you worried about your savings or your RSPs and your shares and all these other things that we accumulate? Remember what Jesus said about those things, about treasures and stuff like that, about food and shelter and clothing? This is what he said. Your Father in heaven knows that you need them. But first seek his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. You mean the RSPs and the trips to Hawaii? No. Food, clothing, and shelter. That's what you need. He will give you all those things if you seek him first and his kingdom and righteousness. Do you believe Jesus? Do you believe this? Paul said that godliness, this is in this very letter, he said that godliness has value for all things, holding promise for both the present life and the life to come. Why? Because, Paul said, we have put our hope in the living God, who is the Savior of all people, and especially of those who believe. Do you believe this? Do you put your complete trust in this, or do you put your trust in your savings account? Or in your stuff? Or in your family? Or in your neighbors, your friends? Where do you put your trust in? See, verse 9 and 10, as we get there now, reveals the common bond we have with people of all ages, past, present, and those in the future. And we need to pay attention to this. Because this is it here. This is the common bond, the common theme. When we desire to get rich, Paul said this, we can fall into temptation and a trap. We can find ourselves in many foolish and harmful desires that will plunge us, Paul said, into ruin and destruction. Now, you don't believe that? Or do you believe that? Let me tell you a story. This is a real person. Didn't happen too long ago. And his name was Gerald. And he understood this at the end of it all. But Gerald, a Canadian, won $10 million on his $2 lotto ticket in 2011. That's pretty amazing, don't you think? Gerald purchased a house with that, as probably many would, but it became party central, hosting those hang-arounds and those relatives you never had before you won $10 million. And he spent his winnings on cars and partying and gifts. And in the end of all of it, Gerald became a farm laborer, just trying to support his girlfriend and six young children. In a short 7 years after hitting the jackpot, Gerald hanged himself in his parents' garage. You see, friends, Gerald found ruin and destruction. He fell into temptation and a trap. He became foolish and did harmful things, and it plunged him into ruin and destruction. Do all winners of lotto do that? Do all people that have money do this? Of course not, but Gerald did. There's a temptation there for the first century Christian as there is for you and me today. Where we put our heart, Jesus said, that's where our treasure is. Godliness with contentment is great gain. You know, folks, we all know that money is immoral. It's neither good nor bad. Yet Paul reminds us here in this last verse, he said, money is the root of all kinds of evil, and indeed it is. As sad as it was for Gerald and people like him, just imagine how shameful it is and how destructive it is for people, for those that follow false teachers who call themselves leaders, Christian leaders, eager for money. They have wandered from the faith, as Paul says here in the last verse, verse 10. And pierce themselves with many griefs. They are self-deceived and deceiving others who follow them. They are producing Geralds in the church. Shameful. You see, our culture, when you think about the contrast between the first century and today, is very rich by first century standards. And more often than not, I would say 99% of the time, it's nothing less than the accumulation of wealth and material possessions. Fame and power and wealth. This is the mantra of our culture. And the evangelical church is running alongside with it for the ride. Because here is it is in a nutshell as I close. Do you have food, clothing, and shelter? Do you have that? Then you have what you need. And if you don't have it, the brothers and sisters should meet that need. Shouldn't they? How about for extras? How about the extras that we want in life? And maybe the extras that we have. Some of us have more extras than others. What about that? Well, maybe, just maybe, we should heed Paul's exhortations if we have extras. Do good. Be rich in good deeds. Be generous and willing to share. Be willing to share. Not like the guy that wanted to take it all with him to the grave. And then, folks, here's the promise from God Himself. If you lay up treasure with God, we will build a firm foundation for the coming age. Then, folks, as the Bible tells us, we will truly, truly know the life that is truly life. Amen. Let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you so much for this wonderful text. As we're winding up this letter, we just thank you for all that we have learned about you. And I pray, as we've been convicted of things, even today, that we would come to you and ask your forgiveness. For you say, you just come to me and ask for forgiveness, and if you mean it, I will forgive you. And Lord, thank you so much for the things that we have, and may we have a grateful heart, and may we be a generous people. Not just within our own communities as Christians, but outside as well. Jesus said, we'll always have the poor. Well, there are many things that we can do to help. Not only each other, but others. So thank you, Lord. We praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks. You have yourself a great week. Shalom.